Make sure you guys hit the subscribe button if you guys are enjoying the content that we're throwing up. And make sure you guys hit the like button if you enjoy the video. And yeah, let's begin. Okay, I'm not even gonna lie. I had no idea that you guys would dig the mask video that we made so much. I had no clue. Like, I was just like, man, this is kind of nuts, right? It took me by surprise. So I was like, okay, well then let's do the follow-up, right? Let's answer what happens next in the mask story. So here's a crazy thing. So like this one really just kind of immediately picks up after the last one, right? And in the last video, it was kind of mask number zero, which officially followed the story of Stanley Ipkiss. Now Stanley was killed by his girlfriend, right? Was killed by, well, I guess his ex kind of at the time, Kathy, and then she wore the mask for a temporary moment when she did take him out, but ultimately it becomes too terrifying for her, right? Like the power that a person possesses when they wear the mask is just too much for her to even handle, right? Because she's afraid she'll become like Stanley. And so ultimately she ends up giving it up. Now when she does, she heads to the local police department to Lieutenant Kellaway, who is the guy that was basically tracking down Stanley Ipkiss in the first story. And as soon as this happens, there's a couple things that go on here. The first is that you do have a situation where you've got one guy who's kind of not really evading arrest, but his lawyer's essentially kind of getting him off the hook. And so that's going to be a little bit of a plot point, or kind of a major plot point later on, but we're not really given the identities of these guys. Instead, Callaway's just kind of given to us as, again, a guy who is not necessarily off the cuff and a little too reckless, but a guy who is pretty emotionally involved in his work, right? And so when Kathy shows up with this mask, she's just kind of like, look, like, this is the mask, this is what Stanley Ipkiss wore to become Big Head. I don't want this thing, right? I don't want to have anything to do with this thing. So she basically gives it to him, and then he initially goes to put it on. And that's when she's like, no, never, ever, ever wear this mask, right? Do not ever, under any circumstances, put this mask on. It'll change you. It'll twist you. It'll turn you into something crazy. So, like, do not do this, right? It's what turned Stanley Ipkiss into the person that he was, because who he became when he wore that mask was not the man that I knew. And so do not become him, right? Do not be just like him. Following that, it all just kind of goes along this path of Kellaway kind of doing his own thing. And initially, he's kind of talking to his partner, and they're just sort of going over, you know, the various cases and so on and so forth. But once he gets home, he kind of looks at this mask, you know, where he's sitting there eating dinner, and he's like, I mean, why shouldn't I put this mask on, right? I mean, like, of course, you know, Kathy told me not to, but she also seemed like she was pretty distraught. She probably wasn't in her right mind. I mean, how bad could this mask possibly be, right? Which you kind of knew that was going to happen, right? Like, anytime there's a story where somebody's like, do not do that thing, then it's like, okay, like, that is a thing I'm going to do. I'm gonna do that thing. And of course, once he puts the mask on, he's like, wow, you know, it's much like Stanley, where he's just sort of swept up into it. Now, one of the big differences here between Kellaway and Stanley Ipkiss is that Stanley Ipkiss went into it blind. He had no idea what he was getting into by putting this mask on. With Kellaway, it's experimentation, because he saw what Stanley Ipkiss did when he had the mask. And so then it's kind of like, when he puts it on, he's like, I wonder if I'll have the same thing, right? So he starts like beating the crap out of himself with a hammer, different thing like that. Like, he shoots himself in the hand, and like, he doesn't really feel any real pain or anything. So it's just kind of like, okay, this is a little bonkers here. Right now, from there, you switch over to those two criminal guys that we were talking about earlier in the story, right? The lawyer and his guy. And the guy with the glasses is named Rapaz, right? And the lawyer is the guy who basically got him off. And as the two of them are sitting down and having dinner, and they're basically eating, they're met by the arrival of a guy who's referred to as Mr. Lister. Right now, this guy is basically the assistant to the assistant district attorney, right? Like the assistant to the DA. So he's kind of the guy who sort of runs things behind the scenes for the DA. For those of you guys who don't know, district attorneys are officially elected, and then you have what are called ADAs, assistant district attorneys. Now, Lister is not an assistant district attorney, right? Like, ADAs are basically prosecutors for the most part, and then the district attorney, like, usually, like, if a DA gets involved in a trial, it's like a huge to-do, right? It's like a major situation that goes on. But for Lister, he is the assistant to the district attorney, right? So he's not really an ADA. He's basically like Dwight from The Office, right? Like, the assistant to the regional manager. But effectively, this guy's on the take. And it's good to have a man in that position if you're a criminal, because you can kind of make a few things go away, right? And the one piece of evidence that's really holding the police department to Rapaz, and really, you know, kind of the one thing that would get him landed in jail, because at the moment he's out on bail, is heroin, right? And so if their assistant district attorney can basically get this to go away, then in turn, the cops will have nothing on Rapaz, and that'll basically be it. And so what you end up doing is switching back to Kellaway. Now, Kellaway himself kind of, you know, experiments with what it is that he's capable of. And so you kind of have these guys who are committing a robbery at like a local gas station or something, or a local store, right? And so as soon as they manage to make their escape, like, they get to their getaway car, and the getaway car is totally busted up, right? It won't start. So once they pop the hood, you've got Kellaway there as the mask, and he's like, I think it's your carburetor, buddy. And immediately gets to work on these guys, right? In the way that we saw the mask doing it in the first issue. And that's one of the cool things, is that like the kind of violence and stuff that you saw in the first video doesn't go away here. And if anything, depending on the circumstance, it's actually more extreme, right? Like, these guys unload on him, and again, like, it doesn't work. work, right? Exactly what you would expect. Like, none of it works. And so ultimately, like, the one guy's basically, you know, had his neck broken while he was in a car and just kind of left there, right? The other two guys bail, right? As soon as they fire shots into this guy, they're like, nope, time to go. Like, they essentially run off and they're running for something like 30 minutes. Now, eventually they circle back around to where their getaway car is, only to find some cops there. And then, of course, you get the scene that most all of you guys know from The Mask, where you've got like, you know, you got Big Head standing there. He kind of pops up behind him and he's like, you know, now that I have your attention, let me demonstrate some balloon sculpting. And I know a lot of you guys are just like, yes. But it's kind of amazing, right? He's like, watch really quick, guys. A few turns of the wrist, right? Like, behold, we have a giraffe, right? A few more turns, a few more well-placed twists. Voila, a French poodle. And then we do a few more twists and we have my personal favorite, a Tommy gun. And like, sprays these guys down. Just like point blank, just sprays these guys to pieces. And then like a couple of cops like, did you hear that? And so like, they basically go running. And then you've got, you know, one of the medics who calls for his partner. And then of course his partner shows up and is like, hey man, yeah, let's get this guy loaded up in the vehicle, right? This guy's hanging on by a thread, right? This guy's neck is almost completely broken. This guy's almost completely dead. And so then it turns out this guy's partner is actually the mask in disguise, right? And like, literally he injects the medic, knocks this guy out, and then in turn, like, takes the face off, which looks exceedingly gruesome. Takes the face off. He's like, do you remember me, buddy? And then like, that's it, right? Like it's kind of messed up. And so that, after that, you pick up with Kellaway showing back up to work. Now, the big difference I think here between Kellaway and Ipkiss is that Ipkiss kind of allowed the mask to almost take control of him. A lot of that was because of the fact that Ipkiss had low self-esteem. He had low personal worth. He was the perfect guy to get a hold of the mask, right? To take a guy who felt like nothing and then have the mask and then feel like he's got the power of God, right? At least only in so far as how he controls himself and what he can kind of create. But with Kellaway, it's a little bit different, right? His is more based on vendettas and different things like that. I mean, I guess it was a little bit with Ipkiss, but again, it's a little more with Kellaway because he's a cop, right? And so his intentions are really more rooted in doing what he believes to be the right thing, just going about it in all the wrong ways. Now, eventually Kathy hits him up, and based on the whole knowledge of what are called like the getaway murders, basically, or I guess the holdup murders is what they call them, Kathy kind of talks to him for a minute, and just based on the little bit of a conversation they have, she seems to kind of pick up on this idea that he may have used the mask at some point along the line, right? It's one of these things where he's kind of like, yeah, don't worry. I mean, you know, I've got the mask. It'll stay safe with me. Never going to use it. Never going to touch it. Anything like that. And that's kind of it, right? You know, it's kind of a throwaway thing. Now, the other part of this is that you end up having Kellaway called into the office of his captain, right? And his captain just starts reading him the riot act. He's like, okay, look, man, like, you were the guy who was in charge of this Rapaz case. We've lost anybody who can offer any real testimony. The guy Rapaz is out on bail. So like, obviously you couldn't keep that from happening based on the evidence that you had. And two, the evidence that you did have is now gone, right? So like you've totally botched this. You've totally screwed it up, right? I mean, he's just getting the riot act read to him. Now, the reality is basically this guy Lister who made it all go away, right? Stephen Lister was a guy who kind of wiped it clean. But I mean, the guy's squeaky clean, right? He's an assistant to the district attorney. Nobody's going to believe this guy's guilty. But Kellaway, right off the bat, just based on his suspicions, is like, it's got to be that guy, right? And so it's kind of a slow build with regards to Kellaway meeting up to him. Because following that, Kellaway ends up, you know, kind of tracking down and finding a handful of guys who were robbing this foreign truck driver, right? And going to take his truck and, you know, do whatever they want with it. And so you've essentially got, you know, you have like Kellaway as the mask who shows up. It's like this barber, right? He's like, wait, everybody, wait. And they're like, what in the hell? He's like, you're not going anywhere with that truck, at least not until you get a decent haircut. And so he's kind of like the guys start kind of giving him a hard time. They're like, dude, get out of here, man, or we're going to kill you. He's like, no, see, here's the problem, man. He's like, here's the problem you have. You got long hair, buddy. And with long hair, somebody could just grab you and just fling you around and throw you into a building. And so he's like, we got to cut your hair, man. We got to take care of that. And all the guys basically end up bolting off, right? And this is where things are a little wonky with the mask, because he's very similar to the Joker in that way, where like, he does things and sometimes they just don't make sense. For example, like, he takes the face off and kind of undoes the costume of like the barber, and this truck driver comes running up on him and he's like, thanks, man. Like, thank you so much, man. Like, you know, it's thank you for keeping our city safe, you know, all that kind of stuff. You know, thank you for protecting us. My wife and children, you know, we all thank you, and that kind of a thing. And so like when he takes the mat or takes the costume off, he's like, no, wait a minute. He's like, this isn't your world. This is Sinatra's world. You and me, we're just living in it, buddy. Scooby-doo-doo, doo-doo-doo, shoo-wop, dop, 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 doo-dop, dop, dop. Frank Sinatra music, and just walks away the whole time, just singing Frank Sinatra, just kind of walking away. And this dude's like, what in the hell? what in the hell just happened? Like, it's these kind of moments that are a little wonky, but it's also what makes the character so cool. Because I'll be honest, this story would be boring as hell if it was like, I have the mask and now I'm just gonna go be a vigilante. Done. I'd be like, okay, so this is like the most cookie cutter story ever. But like little things like that, like it's weird, right? It's just kind of weird and wonky. And it's very similar to the Joker. And so it keeps things pretty interesting here. And so following that, you pick up with Rapaz himself, right? Being out on bail. And so what ends up happening is he basically ends up tracking down this guy or kind of offering drugs to this guy. And when this guy realizes it's Rapaz, he takes off running, right? He immediately bolts, only to run into what is in effect like this kind of giant henchman of Rapaz who never really talks. Now, what they end up doing is the henchman holds him down, Rapaz injects this guy with heroin, and he basically overdoses. But the reason why this matters is because what you end up getting is Kellaway showing back up to the office, only for us to find out this is Rapaz's MO, right? That basically this guy had essentially overdosed and it was designed to look that way. That you had different criminals who would interact and would basically eliminate people who would squeal or snitch in different ways. But with Rapaz, because of his involvement in the drug scene and drug trading, that a lot of the people who had information on him were basically drug dealers. So what better way to get rid of those guys than to make it look like they overdosed, right? And so it's a pretty smart method of getting rid of those guys, right? A pretty smart method of killing off anybody who could essentially rat on you, right? Who could turn you in or offer any real information on you. And so following that, Kellaway, of course, dons the mask and then goes to confront Rapaz himself, finally, right? I mean, it only took forever, right? But he finally ends up tracking down Rapaz. Now, when he shows up here, one of the smart things that Rapaz would do as a drug dealer is he would never carry large amounts of drugs on him. And that's how a lot of drug dealers get busted, right? That like cops roll up on them and they've got, I don't know, like an ounce of drugs on them. And depending on the circumstance, for example, you can possess an ounce of weed and it could just be for yourself. But if you got it packaged into like little dime bags or something, you can be charged with possession with intent to distribute. And it's one of those ways in which, you know, the laws are designed to kind of increase charges artificially on people who break the law. And so that's one of the things that he basically avoids. He always keeps in like a single serving amount of drugs on him and then sells it. And so as soon as he, you know, anybody runs up on him, if a cop questions him or anything, he's not in possession of anything because he already sold it off, right? So again, it's a pretty smart move if you were going to deal drugs. I don't advocate that, right? But it's a pretty smart move if you were going to do that. But of course, you end up having the mask who runs up on Rapaz, you know, and of course, Rapaz doesn't know it, right? It's just some kind of guy who's there. Now, the reality is Rapaz had already arranged to meet up with someone. And so when Kellaway shows up here as the mask in costume, Rapaz is kind of like, okay, like this is a little weird. But again, like Kellaway kind of starts threatening him, right? It's just kind of like, you know, I don't believe you're here to meet a friend, pulls a gun on him, the intention to take him out, that kind of a thing, only for Rapaz's henchmen to basically show up behind him, right? And then immediately grab this guy and throw him into a vehicle. Now, at that moment, Rapaz is kind of like, okay, cool, we're done here, right? But then like this guy gets out of the car, and that's kind of our moment when we realize it's Kellaway. And like, he basically just like takes out a gun and shoots up this henchman. The difference is that this henchman, this guy is almost just like on a whole different level, right? I mean, I wouldn't say he's like all hopped up on drugs, but he's certainly one of these guys that's like huge. Like, he's larger than life and able to take a beating, right? So like, where you have like Kellaway who walks over to Rapaz with the intention of taking him out, the henchman gets back up again, grabs a gun and like starts to get to work on like Kellaway again. So it's one of these small little instances where the mask almost meets a foe that he can't quite overcome, right? But at the end of the day, it doesn't really matter, right? Just because of the fact that he basically ends up grabbing, you know, like an electric line, shoving it into this guy's mouth and just electrocuting the piss out of him, right? So it's like, okay, this guy's basically knocked out, right? He's not dead, but he's knocked out. Now, while that goes on, somebody sees this. Of course, Rapaz ends up taking off and the mask chases after him all the while, like a person's watching this. And finally, Rapaz is cornered, goes to fire a shot and shoots the mask through the head. But of course, the mask is essentially immortal and says, hey, look, man, like, you know, like I'm not necessarily here to kill you, right? I'm just here to understand what's going on, right? I mean, if I wanted to kill you, you'd be dead already. You know, he's like, I'd love to stay in chat, but I got to keep moving, right? I got to keep doing my thing. I got to keep taking out all these different guys. You know, like, you're sweating like a horse, man. Chill, relax. And then as soon as he leaves, Rapaz looks down and it turns out there's an explosive cigarette and it detonates, killing Rapaz. Now, to be honest with you guys, I would say this execution by Kellaway was probably the most satisfying. And the reason why is because, again, keep in mind, Rapaz is like the most powerful mobster in the whole city, right? And like, drug dealing was his main thing. I mean, the guy bribed a jury. The guy had his butler or his henchman, Walter, kill, you know, take out anybody who could, you know, testify against him. The guy used all his influence to avoid jail time. And so it made perfect sense that after all of that, and after all these different mobsters had been involved in Kellaway's ongoing and basically made his life as a cop difficult, that he would finally be able to take out the most powerful guy, right? And so again, it's a pretty satisfying thing there. Now, the thing about this is that when Kellaway's called in the morning by his partner and woken up, you know, Kellaway kind of operates under the idea that pretty much everything he does is never really seen by anybody, only to find out there's a witness to it. And so that's when he's called in really to the DA's office, and everybody's kind of panicking, right? Kellaway knows what's going on and he knows what he did, but everybody's kind of panicking for for a few different reasons. One, because Rip Haz was killed, and that's a big thing, right? Because it looks like somebody intentionally assassinated him or something like that, and so the entire DA's case is basically gone. But the other thing is that information's been leaked out, and the third thing is that Big Head has officially returned, right? People, like, as far as the general public is concerned, this guy's back. And for cops, it scares the heck out of them, because in the last story, like, this guy killed like a dozen cops, and there was nothing they could do to stop him, right? Nothing at all. But the idea of Kellaway's entire career being on thin ice is really kind of saved to a degree by his captain. And the reason why is because his captain kind of pulls him aside and says, look, there's a witness there, but the witness will only talk to a single cop alone. And he's not going to talk to anybody else. He's not going to come into the precinct or anything. So, you know, in order to basically save your career, I'm giving you an out here. You're going to go interview this guy, right? And you're going to go get the information he has. You're going to record it, and you're going to call it a day, right? The problem with this is that it's not Kellaway who shows up to meet this guy. It's the mask. Now, the funny thing about this is that if Kellaway was being smart, and this is how the mask changes you as a person, if Kellaway was being smart, he would have just gone through business as usual. He would have shown up here. He would have got his name cleared. He would have got like everything would have been cool and copacetic, and that would have been it. Such as it was, he ended up donning the mask and then showing up on this guy and then basically kind of terrifying this dude, right? Like absolutely terrifying the hell out of this guy. I was like, hey man, like, you're going to keep to yourself and you're not going to tell anybody anything that you saw, right? Like, you didn't see anything. You were mistaken that you thought you saw something happen, but it turned out that you didn't. I mean, that's kind of the irony of this, is Kellaway ends up basically becoming the kind of person that he avidly fought against as a cop. But that's one of the things that kind of comes in with the nature of the mask, is that it twists you up and it turns you inside out. And it makes you the, you know, seemingly the total opposite of what you are as a person. It makes you your most evil self, right? So it's like the internet. It reveals who you really are on the inside. But again, he just kind of goes on this bit of a tour, taking out all these different criminals and literally just like getting rid of all these guys who commit all these various crimes. Now, the other part of this is that once it's all said and done, where you end up having him, you end up having Kellaway meet up with the captain, then it kind of turns into, okay, like, he starts getting rid of the riot act, because as far as the captain goes, he's screwed up again. That Kellaway's answer here is kind of like, well, I mean, maybe the guy got cold feet, right? I mean, I don't really know what to say. You know, maybe it's just kind of the way those things happen, you know? And ultimately, the captain just kind of starts calling him out, right? Starts screaming at him and calling him out, you know? And it's kind of like, you know, like, we need to make Big Head our priority, right? Like, we have to go after this guy. And where Kellaway kind of shoots it down and is like, no, the captain's answer is, well, you don't want to go after Big Head because you're afraid, right? Because you're a coward. And it's one of these things where, like, he freaks out. And he's like, let me tell you something. Like, if you guys went after Big Head, there wouldn't be any of you guys left, right? He would kill you all. Like, he would take every single one of you guys out. It's really just pure unadulterated insubordination towards a superior officer. And so in response to that, he basically gets a day on the street from his captain, right? Which is not necessarily uncommon. I know at my old job, I got 3 days on the street once, but you get like a day on the street, which is basically a day with no pay. And that's it. It's really more of just kind of a warning, like a little punishment of insubordination. But what you had happen there was a restaurant called Sanity's. And the belief with regards to all the other mobsters is that with Rapaz taking out, that it had something to do with everybody operating out of Sanity's. So they end up sending some of their guys over there for the purpose of taking it hostage, right? And so what Kellaway ends up doing is developing this kind of scheme for himself where he essentially goes in to bust the place, right? He's going to go in, he's like, I'm going to go in there and I'm going to save the day, right? I'm going to go in there and get everything cleared up, right? And I'm going to restore my reputation in my own way. And so when he gets in there, he just kind of starts taking all these guys out as the mask, and he does it in some pretty wild ways, right? Like, he cracks one of the guys over the head with like the rolling pin, and then he makes like a cake and then puts in like a ton of sleeping pills, right? And then like one of the guys eats the cake and like that's it, right? That guy's just kind of out, like literally kills him with sleeping pills, like basically has him overdose. I mean, it's just things like that, right? It's nonsensical and it's goofy, but it's crazy at the same time, right? And one of the genius things that he does is he actually lures these two guys towards each other and then stands on the opposite side of the door so each one sees him. And as he's messing with him, he's like, you know what? Like, I'm gonna bid you a fond farewell. And like basically walks away. And so these guys end up opening fire, not realizing they open fire on each other, right? And they basically take each other out. But it's small little things like that. And so of course he takes the mask off, he leaves, and then he ends up, you know, kind of stepping out there and then gets screamed at by his captain, right? Because he's like, no one here is happy about what you did. Like, sure, the press is all over you, but who cares about the press, right? Like, the mayor's not happy about it, the commissioner's not happy about it, the chief's not happy about it. They've all been chewing my ass out because I'm your captain and I'm not happy about it. And so as it kind of goes on, and as Kellaway kind of shows this complete disregard for what he did in terms of like the chain of command and how it makes his captain look, he's like, you're done, right? Like, that's it. Like, you're over. He's like, I want your letter of resignation, I want your badge, I want your gun, that's it. Like, I don't want to have anything to do with this anymore. So once he gets back home, he's met by the arrival of Kathy, and she's like, I know you've been wearing the mask, I know it's you, right? Like, I know it's you who's doing this. And there's a really kind of interesting conversation here, right? Because as the two of them start to talk, you basically have Kellaway who reveals to Catherine that, hey, look, yeah, I was using the mask, and yeah, I did some pretty unsavory things, but it was all for a better thing, right? It was all for for a better picture. And to a degree, he's not wrong there, right? You know, the nature of the law can be arranged in such a way to where those who know how to manipulate it know how to ensure that people who do genuinely commit crimes get off. More so than that, even if there's actually evidence of you committing a crime, that evidence can be thrown out, right? You know, if it's just like a person with a camera who recorded you, depending on how it was done, that evidence can be dismissed, right? Imagine that. Like, you're caught, like it's a smoking gun catching you in the act, and a judge will willfully get rid of it if the law allows them to. And so it's kind of like, wow, you know, like lawyers being able to manipulate the justice system that way, you know, it's really twisted and screwed up. And so it's kind of interesting to see somebody who's like, look, like, you can't rely on the justice system to do the right thing, right? The justice system is not about getting justice. The justice system is about being able to manipulate it in such a way to where you can get the outcome that you want. And so he's like, I was doing all the wrong things, sure, but I was doing it for the right reasons. And why does it matter if I took out all those mob bosses in the first place, right? It's an interesting concept because there are some very good philosophical arguments for vigilantism. But at the end of the day, it's one of these things where they kind of strike a deal. And what you end up getting is him kind of quote unquote locking away the mask and then saying like, here's the key. And anytime I need the mask, I'll hit you up. And you can be the one to determine whether or not I'm going to be using it for a rightful reason, right? For a rightful cause. And so they're kind of partners in this thing, right? And so she's, you know, in the end, Kathy's kind of like, okay, right? Not everything the mask did was bad. There was some good that came out of it, right? You were killing mobsters who otherwise would have avoided any real consequence because of how the law can be, you know, manipulated. All right, cool. We'll do that. And so ultimately, it's one of those interesting kind of situations there, because what you end up having here is exactly what we knew would happen. The mask is addictive, right? The ability to kind of take the law into your own hands can be an addictive thing, which is why it requires people who are emotionally impartial and people who don't look at things from an emotional standpoint and look at things logically and reasonably and are like, yes, society is better without that person. The law will allow that person to continue their actions. Therefore, we will just get rid of them, right? Like, you need a kind of impartial person who is devoid of emotion in that way to be able to make those rational and intelligent decisions. And so ultimately, Kellaway doesn't do that. Kellaway took an axe and basically busted open the desk and took the mask and left. And so he ends up running up on Lister, on Stephen Lister, and where initially you thought he would kill him, instead, what he ends up doing is snatching him up and dragging Lister back to his office, and then ultimately finds the safe where Lister keeps all his secrets, right? All the money that he's been paid by mobsters in order to allow the things that they want to do to continue on, the drugs that he basically, you know, took away or hid that was the evidence being used against Rapaz, that it was all kind of sitting in a safe. Now, the reality is Lister's stupid for keeping that stuff in his safe. He's an idiot. But all that stuff is taken, and of course, the cops end up managing to make their way in there, and essentially they find Lister, who's there with all the drugs and all the money and this little black book that had documented all these actions that he had been engaging in, and of course he's taken away when the evidence is shown there. Now ultimately you end up having, you know, Kellaway as the mask, who shows up to the captain and Lionel as partner, right? And it's kind of like, you know, you guys have been giving Kellaway a bad rap, right? I mean, you know, I did what you guys couldn't do, right? Like, what you guys couldn't do was figure out that this guy was behind everything, right? So if it wasn't for me, this city would still be crappy. So you guys can hold your applause. I don't really need it, but you guys really should reinstate Kellaway, right? You guys really should bring him back and allow him to go, you know, continue being an officer, because at the end of the day, he's really the only one of you guys who is competent in any real meaningful way. Like, to that, literally the captain's like, open fire, everybody. And they just shoot this guy up, right? He's like, you know, I believe that guns are oftentimes romanticized in society, right? They're stressed too much in culture. What do you guys think? I feel like guns are a little overrated. And like the whole time, he's just pulling like this battle axe out of his jacket, right? Just this giant battle axe out of his jacket and just starts swinging it at everybody. Now Lionel grabs the captain, they jump in the car and they bail, right? They're like, we gotta go, right? And so literally like the whole time, like the captain's like, man, dude, this is absolutely crazy. Like, and Lionel's like, dude, we told you, man. Like, we told you about like Big Head. We told you what he was capable of. Did you think we were lying? Did you think we were making it up, right? And they're like, well, we should call Kellaway. He dealt with this before. Like, why aren't we calling Kellaway? And Lionel's like, because you fired him, remember? Like, it's one of these instances where the captain finally gets his comeuppance and is kind of like, he basically realizes what it is that they're going up against, right? They're like, Big Head's not somebody to trifle with, right? And so ultimately, Big Head like literally rips the top off the cop car and then chases after the captain, snatches him up. And the captain's like, man, I had to open fire on you, right? I was just doing my job. Like, it's what I had to do. And literally just kind of like, done, right? Captain's donezo. And so following that, like he goes after Lionel and actually has the intention of killing Lionel, right? Like, literally has the intention of killing him. Like, grabs some dynamite, shoves it in his mouth, goes to light it, and is like, no, I can't kill my partner. Like, I can't kill my friend. No way I can do that, right? And so ultimately, like, does does away with the stuff and then takes the mask off, like goes back to his place, takes the mask off and is like, done, right? Like, I can't have anything to do with this anymore, right? Like, you know, he makes it look like he destroyed himself. He didn't. But what he does do is he basically goes into the basement of his house and buries the mask under cement, right? Now, while that's going on, you of course have Kathy at the house and she's like, we have, like, you know, she's kind of basically telling him what he already knows. He's like, we have to do something about this. But essentially that's it, right? Like, as far as Kellaway is concerned, the mask is gone, right? It's buried under cement and doesn't want to have anything to do with it, right? It's all basically done and gone, like swept under the rug, and that's the end of that. The funny thing about this is that it's not, and the mask does come back. But with that being said, guys, we're gonna bring this video to an end. If you are new here to Comics Explained, make sure you guys hit the sub button to become part of the Rob Corps. If you guys enjoyed this video, make sure you drop a like, and I will catch you all later. Peace.